God is good all the time.
Put a song. Good morning, church, and all our viewers. I hope you are all staying safe and staying inspired in the Lord. We are thankful to the Lord for a wonderful and anointed media service last week, especially the message by Reverend Dr. David Quay entitled "The Power of an Organized Life in Doing God's Will." Amen. Let's remember 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Hallelujah. I am Sister Maravik, your presider for this week. Our theme from the Lord for 2024 is "Look up and see your salvation and promotions draw nigh," a year of great promotion for His glory, found in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 3. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. May the good Lord continue to use us to be a blessing to many and even unto the nations of the world. Amen. Let us continue to be united in prayer for the gospel to reach all nations. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Many thanks once again for all your earnest prayers and faithful support for our digital discipleship church program. By the way, our presenters for this week are the following. Scripture reading is by Brother Rachel Van Raja. Worship leading is by Sister Kenneth and the worship team. Exhortation is by Sister Dana Winson. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Prayer of the Nation of Malaysia will be led by Pastor Deborah Ho from FGCCI Main Church. The Word of God will be shared by Reverend Josephine de Vila from Word of Life Cornerstone Glory Church, representing FGCCI Philippines. Closing and benediction will be conducted by Reverend Dr. David Quay, Senior Pastor and Spiritual Overseer of FGCCI. Praise the Lord. Stay tuned, church, and let's look forward for a great year together. Amen. Hallelujah.
Good morning, church, and all our viewers. Today's scripture reading is taken from the book of James, chapter 1, verse 2 to 12. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. The brother in humble circumstances ought to take pride in his high position, but the one who is rich should take pride in his low position, because he will pass away like a wild flower. For the sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossoms fall and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich man will fade away even while he goes about his business. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. May the Lord bless the scripture reading for today. Stay safe and God bless. Amen.
God is good. Hello, church. Good morning once again. Welcome to FGCCI Media Service.
All to be my own. all our death. Hallelujah. Thank you. Amen.
All the time, through the darkest night, His light.
Good morning, church, and all our viewers. Today, I would like to share my exhortation on title, God's Restoration. Life often brings seasons of loss, regret, and pain, where it feels as if years have been wasted. Yet, the promise found in God's word is clear. He will restore all the wasted years. This divine assurance can be found in Joel chapter 2 verse 25, where God declares, I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten. This means that even when it seems like time and opportunities have been taken away by hardship, mistakes, or things we cannot control, God can make things right again. To understand this promise, we need to look at what happened to the people of Israel. They went through a terrible locust plague that destroyed their crops and their ways of life. This was a punishment for their disobedience to God, but God in His mercy promised to restore what they had lost. This promise was not just about giving them back their crops and livelihood, but also about renewing their spirits. God wanted to heal their hearts, bring them closer to Him, and bless them abundantly. What exactly is restoration? God's restoration is a process that brings healing and renewal to every aspect of our lives, whether we are dealing with physical illness, emotional wounds, broken relationship, or lost opportunities. Restoration can be defined as the act of returning something to its former condition, making something new again, or also make things better than their current state. Our Heavenly Father, restoring power is one of the greatest promises from the Scripture. God can take our brokenness and create something beautiful. His restoration goes beyond simply fixing what is broken. It involves a complete transformation that brings forth new life and purpose. In our own life, wasted years can take many forms. They might be years spent pursuing goals that didn't lead to success, or struggle with health, or make wrong decisions that kept us from living fully, or even times when we felt spiritually dry and distant from God. These wasted years can leave us feeling overwhelmed by a deep sense of loss, leading to a feeling of hopelessness, and despair. Yet God's promise of restoration is far greater than these losses. He is not limited by time, and His power to redeem and restore is infinite. No matter how many years we feel we have wasted, God can turn them around. When we place our trust in Him, He begins a process of healing and renewal that goes beyond what we can imagine. One of the key ways God restores our wasted year is by transforming our pain into purpose. Romans chapter 8 verse 28 reminds us, when we knew that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him and called according to His purpose. This means that every experience we go through, no matter how painful, is not wasted in God's hand. He uses this experience to shape us, to build our character, and to prepare us for the future He has planned for us. Our trials and hardship can become a powerful testimony of God's faithfulness. When we go through difficult moments or times, we often feel alone and overwhelmed. But as we trust in God and see His hand at work in our life, our faith grows stronger. This experience allows us to witness God's grace and mercy, transforming our pain into a story of hope and redemption. Furthermore, when we share our experience of how God has brought us through tough time, we can offer comfort and encouragement to those who are facing similar challenges. Our testimony can provide hope to others that they are not alone and God is capable to restoring their life as well. 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 10 says, "After you have suffered a little while, God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you." God's restoration often involves a renewal of joy and hope. Psalm 51 verse 12 says, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me." Sometimes we may lose our way, get distracted, chasing the wrong things. God's promise for restoration doesn't only apply to our physical bodies, but our spirits as well. When we seek God again, He will turn our hearts toward Him. Our joy and peace return as we ask His forgiveness and submit to His plan instead of our own. When we turn to God in our brokenness, He fills us with new sense of joy that goes beyond our circumstances. When we are feeling down and overwhelmed by the weight of our past, God's joy lifts us up. This joy is not dependent on our situation, but is deeply rooted in His unwavering love for us. It is the joy of knowing that we are loved and valued by God, and that He has a good plan for our life. God's joys give us courage to face each new day with hope. It reminds us that He is in control, that no matter what happens, we can trust Him to take care of us. This assurance allows us to let go of our past regrets and fear and to embrace the future with confidence. When God restores our joy, He also renews our hope. We start to see possibilities where there were once only obstacles. We begin to believe good things can happen and our life can be filled with meaning and purpose. God also restores our life by giving us new opportunities and blessings. Isaiah chapter 43 verse 19 says, "Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and river in the desert." This verse shows that where there was once emptiness and barrenness, God brings forth new life. He opened doors that seems permanently closed and provide blessings that go beyond our expectation. When we feel like we have wasted time or missed out on opportunities, it is easy to become discouraged. But God is always at work creating new paths and possibilities for us. He turns our desert into a place of abundance and renewal. This is a powerful promise to His grace and His ability to make all things new. God's new beginnings are often unexpected and can come in ways we never imagined. He might open up a new job opportunity or provide a fresh start in a place where we never thought possible. These blessings remind us that with God, nothing is impossible. He's always able to bring good out of even the most difficult situation. When God brings new opportunities and blessings, it's a sign of His deep love and care for us. These new beginnings are also a chance to grow in faith and trust in Him. As we step into these new opportunities, we can be confident that God is with us, guiding us and providing us every step of the way. God's restoration touches every aspect of life too. It doesn't just fix one part of us, but brings healing and renewal to our entire being. God heals our broken heart, mend our relationship, restore our health, and renew our mind. Jeremiah chapter 30 verse 17 says, "For I will restore health to you, and your wounds I will heal," declares the Lord. We can go for a walk every day and do exercise and cook healthy meal at home. All these are good for our body and help us regain our strength that we may have lost during illness or injury. But nothing can fully restore us like God can. As we seek God's restoration, He's able to heal and restore our health. He gives us strength to overcome illness and weaknesses. God also brings renewal by transforming our thoughts and attitude. He helps us to let go of negative thinking and embrace a mindset of hope and positivity. He brings peace where there was confusion. He provides clarity. When we surrender our past to Him, He begins a work in us and through us that leads us to complete transformation. This transformation is not just about changing our circumstances, but also changing from the inside out. God's healing touches our emotion wounds, and bring comfort and peace to area of deep hurt and pain. He repairs the broken places in our heart, helping us to forgive and let go of the past hurt. This healing allows us to experience joy and freedom we never thought possible in our relationship. God's restoration, reconciliation and renewal. He helps us to mend broken connection, restore family brokenness, build strong bond and create healthy, loving relationships. It's also important to remember that God's timing is perfect. While we may want immediate restoration, God knows the best time and the way to bring it about. Trusting in His timing requires faith and patience, but it also helps us to go closer to Him. As we trust in His timing and surrender our past mistake or challenge to Him, we can be confident that He will make all things new. As we wait, God teaches us to rely on His strength. This period of waiting can be challenging, but it's also a time of rich spiritual growth and preparation. We learn to lean on God more, understand that His ways and timing are always best. During this time, God works on our heart and mind, shaping us to be ready for the blessings and restoration He has planned. We develop a deeper faith, knowing that God is faithful and will fulfill His promise at the right time. We learn patience, perseverance, and trust. We come to appreciate God's presence in our life more deeply and recognize His hand in everyday moment. When God's restoration comes, it's more wonderful than we could imagine. We are not only restored, but also transformed by the journey of waiting and trusting. We are better prepared to embrace the fullness of His promise and live abundantly in His grace. God's restoration is also a reflection of His love and mercy. God's desire for us to live an abundant and fulfilled life. When God restores, He does it so abundantly, leave us with heart of full of gratitude and a testimony of His goodness. Our test and trial become testimony of His amazing grace and power. Amen. Thank you for listening, Church. Take care and God bless us all.
God is good all the time.
Let's pray for the nation of Malaysia. Heavenly Father, we come before Your throne of grace, O Lord. We thank You, Father, for this land of Malaysia. This land belongs to You, O Lord, that You have wonderfully created this land, O Lord. Father, we commit Malaysia and we ask You to open heavens upon Malaysia. Let Your angels ascend and descend and move mightily in this nation. And may Your Holy Spirit move to in this nation, O Lord, to touch the lives of Your people, O Lord. Father, we thank You, Father, O Lord, for Malaysia that has been led by a very stable government, O Lord. I pray, Father, O Lord, that we continue to live in harmony and unity and in love, O Lord, caring for each other, O Lord, and that the government of the day, O Lord, will focus on helping the people, O Lord, and continue to do great and mighty things for this nation, O Lord, and to rebuild whatever has been lost, O Lord. We thank you, Father, O Lord, for Malaysia, and we ask, Father, O Lord, that you revive the economy of Malaysia, O Lord, and that the poor and the needy, O Lord, will have their needs met in this nation, O Lord. We thank you, Father, O Lord, that your angels continue to go forth, O Lord, to provide for their needs, O Lord, and that many will come to know you as Lord and Savior, O Lord. We thank you, Father, O Lord, for our Prime Minister, that you continue to bless him and his family, to protect him and his family, O Lord, and that his cabinets and leaders, O Lord, will have wisdom, knowledge, and understanding in all the things that they do, O Lord, and that they will serve this nation, O Lord, with a good stewardship and a good heart, O Lord. We thank you, Father, O Lord, for this nation, and that we ask, Father, O Lord, that you continue to bless your churches in this nation as well, and that those refugees and those needies that are residing in Malaysia, O Lord, that you also will take care of them and provide for their needs, O Lord. We thank you, Father, O Lord, for this nation, and we commit this entire nation to you, knowing, O Lord, you are Lord and Savior of this nation. In Jesus' mighty name, we ask and pray. Amen, amen, amen.
Praise God, a blessed day to all of you. And here I am again, back to share the Word of God. I know that heaven and earth shall pass away, but the Word of God will never pass away. If you have your Bible, you can turn with me in the book of Romans, chapter 1. The Word of God says, "Therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship." May the Lord God bless the reading of His Word. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for having this blessed opportunity to share your words, O God. I pray for your anointing upon your servant that I might speak your words according to your will and plan. Bless the viewers of this program and bless us together as we divide your words. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen and amen. Praise God. Our topic today is about committing your all to Jesus. In every believers, Jesus was always demanded one's all in following him. He never made an exemption. He will not accept a partial commitment, but he need a full commitment. The Apostle Paul provides a theological framework for what it means to follow Christ totally and the consequential changes it makes in a person's life. This sermon will remind the hearer that God expects unconditional surrender. But once made, a metamorphosis takes place that changes a person into the real life they seek. Have you ever done the hokey punky? It's that little song and dance that tells us to put our left arm or right leg or some other body part of our body into the circle. Shake it and then turn around. Turn around and dance with boogie boogie and turn around. It's an active and sometimes tiring little exercise that ends with a command. Put your whole self in. Put your whole self in. In the book of Romans, in our scripture, chapter 12, verse 1, "Therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship." To present your bodies is Paul's way of saying, put your whole self in. The song and dance routine we call worship involves offering our whole person to God. That's more difficult than the dance routine. Most of us understand the idea of giving an offering of money at the church. There are platter and envelopes, and we put our money or our check in an envelope and drop it in the plate. It represents an acknowledgement of God's blessings in our life. It represents our commitment to the ministry of the congregation. It is a part of our worship. It is a way in which we open up the windows of heaven so God can bless us even farther. And then the promise in Malachi 3:10 that He will rebuke the devourer for our name's sake, and He will open the windows of heaven and pouring out the blessings that there is no room enough to receive it. And in the preceding verse, prove me now, says the Lord, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. Okay. But all of us, without exemption, need some help with the idea of offering ourselves to God to put our whole self in the Lord's presence. We can't put ourselves in an envelope. We can't climb into the plate when the answer comes by saying, my offering today, my offering today is myself. Worship is the total commitment of the total person for the total life. Anything less is not genuine worship. Real worship happens when we confess our sin and turn from that sin and then offer ourselves completely and wholeheartedly to God. The Bible says in Romans 10:9, if you confess your sin, He is faithful and just. In Romans 10, He is faithful and just to forgive us. Romans 10:10. We offer ourselves to God because of her mercy. By the mercies of God, we are what we are. That's why we can offer ourselves to God because of His mercy. Paul presents God's mercy as the strongest argument for giving ourselves to God. I urge you by the mercies of God to present your bodies when we recognize what God has done for us through His Son, Jesus Christ. The only response is to give ourselves completely to Him. What did Jesus did? He gave His life as an atonement for our sin. His blood is the perfect forgiveness and the cleansing of the blood. He offered His life for our forgiveness, for our reconciliation to the love of the Father. Jesus is the grace giver, the one who saved us. Number two, we offer ourselves to God as a living sacrifice. To present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasant to God in Romans 12:1, the expression of living sacrifice is set against the backdrop of the Old Testament sacrifice, what it is meant to be. While the Old Testament worship offered an animal, the New Testament worship is to offer himself or herself to Jesus as our perfect sacrifice, to offer ourselves or herself to God, to Jesus himself as a perfect living sacrifice. And then the number three is we offer ourselves to God all the time, not only Sunday. Not only Sunday going to the church, we present our bodies holy and acceptable. We pass and pray. We join our worship. We attend church service. But now God wants us to offer ourselves to God all the time. Living implies life. Life is an everyday experience. A living sacrifice is a sacrifice that is alive and continuous in action. That the word that we hear, the word without action is dead. True worship is our personal linking of faith and works, the offering of every life to God. So every day we depend on God because we are nothing without God, and God is in control in our life. In every situation, whether it is good and bad, God is in control. That's why we are urged to offer our everyday life to God. Number four, we offer ourselves to God through transformation and renewed. In Romans 12:1, I urge you to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. And in verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but ye be transformed by renewing of your mind to do what is good and perfect will of God. So what do you mean by renewed? There are transformations. There are a lot of process in serving God, not only just an overnight changes. So we are changing from glory to glory because once we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, the old self has gone. That is transformation. That from glory to glory, we are new person in Christ. And then we need to know what is good and what is evil, and we need to renew it. We change our behavior. We are new person in Christ. The old self has gone, the new has come. That is transformation. There is a great transformation when we receive Jesus Christ and have a commitment to Him, to serve Him every single moment of our life. Na serious ang commitment. Serious ang commitment. We offer. So we need to be a new person. We need to be born again. We are a new person in Christ. That's why we are born again. We demonstrate our commitment by refusing to conform to this world, but being transformed. Do not conform. So we cannot be equally yoked with the unbeliever in this world because this world is very dirty and this world is difficult to get in. That's why we have Jesus in our life. God picked up from the dust of this world, from the dirt of this world, to be a new person in Christ. So we need to refuse to conform to this world by being transformed through renewed mind. Do not be equally yoked with unbeliever. Do not be conformed. Meaning to say, do not be equally. Be renewed because you are a precious child. You are a peculiar child. You are chosen. That your generation, your citizenship is in heaven. And the blessings of the Lord is upon you. The anointing of the Lord is upon you. Do not make dirt to your body. Do not poison yourselves on the things beneath, but set your affection on the things above, which is the life that are ruled over by the Lord Jesus Christ. The life that are set apart from this world. Always remember that God loves us so much. He gave Himself, He died on the cross for you and for me, so that you can have a reconciliation with your Father and you can receive the plan of the Lord, and the blessings of the Lord will be upon us. So committing your all to Jesus. Number one, we offer ourselves to God because of His mercy. We offer ourselves to God as a living sacrifice and pleasing to God. We offer ourselves to God all the time. We offer ourselves to God through transformation and renewed. Are you ready to put your whole self into the arms of God? Are you ready to commit your all to Jesus? Worship is the free offering of ourselves to God, ever renewed, because ever perfect. It expresses the consciousness that we are His by right, yet we have not duly passed into the hands. Always remember, my dear friends of mine, commitment is the giving of all one knows to Himself, to all one knows of God. anything less than total commitment is unacceptable to God. We pray to the Lord that everything that we have and everything we do can glorify God. That is pleasing in His sight. The word that we spoke, the word that we speak, it will be a word of wisdom and it will be a word of blessing. Set your mind to the things above, not to the things of beneath. Remember that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through Him. It is my prayer, my brothers and sisters, that the blessings and the promises of God, the 7,000 precious, precise promises of the Lord, be upon us and that manifests in our life. I pray to God that the blessings of the Lord will be upon us and the blessings of good health, the blessings of joy, the blessings of encouragement, and the blessings of wisdom be upon us as His people. May the Lord God bless you. May the joy of the Lord be upon you. And I pray to God that He will continue to uphold us in the hollow of His righteous hand. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I praise you and I thank you for you are so awesome. You are so marvelous and you are so great in our life. I thank you, Lord, for your message that we received today. And I pray for your anointing upon your message, God, that your message, Lord, will glorify your name, O Lord. And it will bring blessing to the viewers of this program and the hearer as well, Lord. I pray for this mass media production that the blessings of Abraham will be upon this production, O God. And I pray for the administrations, people around this mass media, God, especially Bishop Reverend David Kuy, O Lord, that you continue to pour out your wisdom upon him, that you continue to enlarge his territory, to continue to uphold him to bring more souls for your glory and honor. And I pray, Lord, that even the members of the church, O Father, that the blessings of abundance be upon them. Thank you so much, O God, for your words today. Thank you, Lord God, for your anointing. And Lord, I pray that as we divide your words, as we hear your words, O God, rivers of living water will flood in our midst, O Lord. This message, I commit it into your hands today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in the mighty name of Jesus, amen and amen. Praise God.
Good morning, church, and all our viewers. Thank you once again for tuning in to FGCCI Media Channel. I hope that you are richly blessed by this week's media service, and I also hope that you are staying strong in the Lord. Hallelujah. I'd like to take this time to thank all the presenters for their wonderful efforts, especially our dear sister Marabik for her wonderful and cheerful presiding always. And also our dear brother Turai for his excellent scripture reading. And also our dear sister Kenneth and the worship team for leading us into a wonderful time of worship in God's presence. Hallelujah. I want to especially thank Sister Dana Vincent for giving us such a wonderful and powerful and insightful exhortation and so inspiring entitled God's Restoration. I know that you are blessed by this exhortation as well. I also want to thank Pastor Deborah Ho for her prayer for the nation of Malaysia. Let us continue to pray for economy and spiritual revival in the land of Malaysia. Hallelujah. I also want to specially thank our speaker this week, Reverend Josephine de Vila, for giving us a wonderful and a blessed message entitled Committing Our All to Jesus. In fact, I just want to add, committing all to Jesus in doing God's will. Hallelujah. And in summary, I just want to read to you from the book of Philippians, chapter 3, verse 13. This is the writings of Apostle Paul. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. In verse 14, I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. In fact, the one thing that Apostle Paul desiring and focus on is to press on in doing God's will. Hallelujah. So that should be our motivation as well and our attitude. Continue to press on in fulfilling God's will for our life. Because God has a great purpose for us on this earth before we go to heaven. So we need to have this attitude and this motivation to forget our mistakes, our past behind, and to press forward to God's high calling upon our life. That's why we need to commit our all to Jesus for that purpose, to fulfill God's will for our life. And committing our all to Jesus, here like Apostle Paul just spoken, is also a process. It's also a process. It's also a goal that we set, that we continue to press forward to a high calling of God upon our life. We continue to commit in a greater way. But the goal is that we will commit our all unto Jesus in doing God's will. And sometimes we may make mistakes, or sometimes we may fall. Do not be disappointed or discouraged. Just continue to press on. That's why Apostle Paul say, forgetting those things we are behind, and press forward to the upper call of God in Christ Jesus. That should be our motivation, and that should be our attitude as well. Hallelujah. And I just want to read one more verse of the scripture found in Luke chapter 9, verse 62. But Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back his feet for the kingdom of God. It's so important. Have a goal. Don't press on like Apostle Paul did. And do not look back. So you will be fit to do the will of God and to advance God's kingdom. Let us set this goal to commit above all to Jesus in doing God's will. Hallelujah. I hope that this short summary will richly bless your hearts. And as usual, we're going to give our tithes and our offerings and love gift to the Lord. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, even as we lift up, Lord, this tithes and this offering and this love gift before thy throne of grace, bless, Lord, this giving for the advancement of your kingdom and for the glory of your name. Return back, Lord, your blessings upon every giver, 100-fold, 60-fold, and 30-fold. And let this gospel of the kingdom be preached in every nation till the day, Lord, of thy coming. Father, in all this we pray in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, church, and all our viewers once again for tuning in to FGCCI Media Channel. And before we conclude this week's media service, I'd like to give you a benediction. Just close your eyes and hearken to the benediction. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious towards you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. May the Lord stretch forth his hands of favor and of blessings and of providence and of protection upon you and upon your family, upon your loved ones. And we continue to commit our all to Jesus in doing God's will. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, church, and our viewers once again for tuning in to MDCCI Media Channel. Let us continue to stay strong and stay inspired in the Lord together.
Jesus.